The development of the environmental movement in the United States was something that was organized mostly by men, by white men, in fact, including the Sierra Club, John Muir and so forth, Audubon's. Well, we have a guest, Michelle Perot, who kind of breaks the mold, or broke the mold. I think these days things are becoming a little bit more diverse in terms of the leadership of the environmental movement in the United States. She's the international vice president now of the Sierra Club, and actually you formerly were the president of the Sierra Club.
Right.
The role of women in the environmental movement, Michelle.
Well, particularly the role of women in the world as the major nurturers, that they are the people that are working on the natural resource base, providing for the families, for their food, for their energy, particularly rural women worldwide. And there's been a large matter of concern from women around the world to focus attention on the plight of women whose real services have not been measured as far as the workload that they have around the world, particularly the rural women. And the United Nations in 1991 ran a major conference to bring attention to the fact that agencies, for example, foreign assistance agencies, multilateral development banks, the World Bank included, needed to place greater attention on the monies that they were giving, so that they were not just given to a family, that they were not just given to the men, but that they were given particularly to women who were doing the majority of the work, so that there would be greater attention to aid for what they were servicing. They didn't usually measure in the economy the role of women. They were growing crops for the family, whereas the men might be growing crops for export that was paying for large debt. But the burden back on the woman caring for the family and for the food needs, she was having problems finding adequate soils to grow the crops and getting adequate amounts of money in order to take care of the family needs. There were assumptions that when you gave money, that it would be equally distributed to the children and to the man and the wife. But what they were finding was that in many cases, if the men who got the money, they might not put it on food for better nutrition for the child. It might buy TVs, or it might buy some other kinds of implements that were not helping for the general nutrition. The woman seemed to have a more caring role, and actually a larger role, even in agriculture, in many of the rural areas.
In terms of attitude on environmental issues, a lot of polls have shown women having a less favorable attitude towards certain environmental threats. Nuclear power, for example, seems to be something that more men support than women, but on the other hand, not that many people support nuclear power at this point, period. What do you think that's based on?
Well, I'm not so sure of all the statistics on that, but clearly the issue has even come up about women's concerns that they raised in regard to, there were numbers of concerns women around the world raised as people were going to Rio in Brazil to talk about new ways of taking care of the environment, and they had major concerns for military activities. They wanted to see a reducing of military, a reducing of explosions of military bombs or for testing, because they're the ones who send the children and care about what's happening to their children. That's not to say that the fathers don't, but they go to the war. And so there was this nurturing, caring aspect that women have a greater burden of on a daily basis. They're the ones who have to watch, make sure the children go to school or they get educated. They have to take care of the energy needs, the food needs, the cooking, all of those things. And so they're always in a caring mode. And in part, when they talk about men and women, they often will say women tend to be able to express themselves more and to be more caring. That's not to say men are not. But they have just been overlooked in the development area as far as providing resources, particularly in the form of financial assistance. They have overlooked what role women play, and they play a majority of the even greater role than the men, and that needs to be addressed in the way in which aid is provided to them.
In terms of the environmental movement in this country and elsewhere, how have women now become involved? I mean, is it still mainly male, white male, or is it at this point substantially more diverse?
I think as you find more people getting educated, you find more women in positions. I can only say that in my own organization, the Sierra Club, we've never thought of a problem of the men being having greater roles than the women, although that was an old boys network in the very beginning, and being the second president in its 100-year history, that does say something. But I never felt pressured within the movement that there was a male thing or a female thing in any way, though I must say when I first started out in school and wanted to go to forestry college, they had to find another woman because there were only men there. About 2 years later, I understand there were 42 women in the school. And so things have changed quite a bit there.
What motivates your environmental activities?
Me personally?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I came into the movement, as many do, as a child, where you have a contact with the outdoors and you have a feeling for it. I was lucky to grow up in New York City, where I was provided with a garden to grow in a public school system. And I loved the smell of the earth, and I loved how I felt, and I felt that if more children would have that contact, the world would be a better place. So I continued with that, and so I have it from the heart, and it's very helpful to have that when you work on issues that sometimes take 10 years just to get them accomplished, or sometimes even 20 years. And I found in talking to others that are as involved, and I've been with the movement 30 years, those that have a long staying power have a real connection from their heart to the natural resource base. And so the more you work in it and the more you see that you can make change, you just love what you're doing and you stay with it.
Michelle Perreault, the International Vice President of the Sierra Club, will be back with Enviro Close Up right after this.
Hope alone can't save our seas, save our soil, or save our skies. Can't wait. You are the hope for the future.
Michelle Perreault is the International Vice President of the Sierra Club, and one of her focuses has been the role of women in environmental improvement, environmental change. And it's quite difficult in many places in the world where sexism, where discrimination against women is, it's still the way things are. How does it all work in terms of what you're trying to do in these sort of countries where males continue to dominate?
Well, I've just been privileged as being the International Vice President to have contact with women from other countries and to learn that it's not so easy for them to speak out in terms of concerns about their environment in their countries because depending on, in some cases, the government that's in charge, if they speak up, then they have to fear for their lives, such as Wangari Maathai in Kenya, an environmentalist who was interested in having a park protected from having a building put in it, and when she spoke out in her government, she had to worry about her life. And actually, one of the lucky things about the networks that have been forming for women is that we were able to, around the world, cry out on her behalf. And so the government had to release her from jail after bringing her in. It's those kinds of concerns about women's rights, particularly women in the environmental movement or women that are concerned about their environment, that many women around the world would like to aid. In other cases, if there isn't a government that's a problem, there are differences in culture which prevent women from speaking out. There are men in many cultures who do not want the women to meet with them. And so the women are unable to have a dialogue with the men who might have the money, but the women who see the need to fix, let's say, a sewage system in a country. There are cases where men have just been used to doing the job, and they don't want to give women the power. And so the women have real problems to speak out, because then they will be ostracized by their families. So around the world, women are trying to help each other get greater abilities to speak out, have more access for credit so that they can buy things that they need, particularly when they're growing crops and things, they have some more access for the tools that they are required to take care of the families. There are good examples where women with access to money, such as the Grameen Bank in Bangladesh, have suddenly been able to change and have a greater status as women, which in turn we know has a greater effect on protecting the environment because it takes them out of poverty. And there is a relationship between poverty and degradation of the environmental base. We also know when women's status is raised, they in turn have more choices about how to plan their families and whether to go into a job or to have more children. But if they're not given that increase in status, then sometimes they have no choice but to have additional children that will then help them with the major burdens that they have. And so it's important to give them a chance to say what do they need, to provide the education that has been, again, not a high priority for teaching women in many countries, and so their literacy rate has a huge gap between that of men. And until they have that education, then they can't be the proper managers that they are so capable of being. So there's a need for networking of women worldwide to call out the plight of women that have a great potential to do this leadership, and it's just sitting there unused. Make sure that women have access to speaking to the very institutions that are responsible for allocating loans or grants out, so the women can say, this is what we need, this is what will work, and not leave it up to governments who aren't necessarily aware or concerned that the women would have a role.
We'll be back with Michelle Perot and Enviro Close-Up right after this.
Don't worry, the safety valve is absolutely reliable. There is no need for concern. And anyway, once it's there, we might as well use it. Trust us. Save our seas, save our soil, or save our skies. Act now. The world can't wait. You are the hope for the future.
Michelle Perot is the International Vice President of the Sierra Club, talking about women and environmental change and the differences around the world. Can you describe them?
Well, clearly in continents like Africa and Asia and Latin America, the developing countries, which have so many of the rural women, they face problems that are quite extreme. Particularly, they have countries that are paying back heavy debt, which places a burden on the very economic structure of the countries that they're part of. However, still in North America, there are women, too, that have problems, and I myself was thinking, well, when I was at this conference with women from around the world, there wouldn't be too many problems in North America. Went into one of the meetings, and there was a woman crying from North America. She had was from a southern state, and it turned out that she had been oppressed as a woman by men who were threatening her life because she was trying to close a toxic waste site that was hindering and making health problems for the children in the area, and they were saying she was affecting their jobs. So she, too, had a problem. But I think the very large problems that the women in the other continents face, dealing with the debt issue, which is high on their list as a problem, they see that affecting them. I think it's important that the American women understand the plight of women worldwide. It's not an issue that is familiar to us, so we need to learn more about our sisters in other countries and help them with those problems, since our own country is part of the problem in the way in which we provide aid and support to institutions like the World Bank.
And how too? How can the help be provided?
Well, we can pressure our own elected officials about the fact that we think that that debt, which is causing great extraction of the natural resource base upon which these women depend for a livelihood, is so high that there must be some reduction of that debt, and we must play a role in the United States to relieve it.
And Sierra Club has apparently a very special program doing this kind of thing.
We've been involved for many, many years trying to reform the lending institutions and trying to find other ways so that the burdens are not placed on countries, so they end up degrading their resource base simply to pay out money on an interest.
Michelle Perot, this is Enviro Close-Up. I'm Carl Grossman.
It's coming. The most significant event in automotive history. It's coming. The end of the age of the automobile. Save our seas, save our soil, or save our skies. Act now. The world can't wait. You are the hope for the future.
Welcome back to Enviro Close Up. The rainforests have been a crucial issue for a number of years now, a crucial environmental issue, but it's not just the rainforests of South America, it's not just the rainforests of tropical zones that are endangered. Indeed, the great forests of the northern United States are very much threatened, and Brock Evans is Vice President, National Affairs for the Audubon Society. Brock, describe the threat today.
That's a good point. We're starting to realize that it is, as you said, it's not just tropical forests that are threatened, but we're really deforesting the planet all across the world. The temperate forest zone, like the rainforests of the Pacific Northwest, and then also the northern forests, such as you have here in northern New England. And what's happened up there, you have about 26 million acres of land going in a band across northern Maine, northern Vermont, northern New Hampshire, and northern New York, including the Adirondacks. A small fraction of that is publicly owned and relatively protected. Most of it's been owned by timber companies for a long time, which had been clear cutting and logging and basically destroying the biodiversity that was already there. Now these companies are considering selling and getting out and going somewhere else. They're also starting to subdivide their properties and selling off lakefronts and waterfronts and compromising the land forever from an ecological standpoint. So we're trying to first educate the public of what's going on to the forest up there and about the opportunities are there to restore it and bring it back. And secondly, trying to find the money and the where and the political will to do it.
In, here in the United States, people can buy and own pieces of the planet and essentially do what they want with those pieces.
Right.
There are certain limits, but the limits are pretty far. I mean, how are you going to convince some paper company in Maine? How are you going to convince some industrial facility in upstate New York to keep the forest green, to preserve? And so how are you going to do it?
Well, you can't convince them to do that because forest laws for private land are regulated by the local states, and the state of Maine has very, very weak laws or almost no laws at all to do that. So you can fly across Maine, for example, in the vast northern part, which has almost no one living in it, it's owned by these companies, and see clear cuts 25 square miles long. I mean, it's really It looks like a third world country in some of the devastation. But now they've cut so much, they themselves want to sell the land. They themselves want to go somewhere else, maybe move to the southeast or some other place. So the public has an opportunity to buy these lands and restore them and bring them back. Plus, some of it still hasn't been logged yet and it could be saved. And it's the same opportunity we had as we had around the turn of the century here, when a lot of lands were cut over in the south and across the eastern part of the country, and Congress passed the Weeks Law in 1911, which permitted the establishment of a national forest system in east of the Mississippi. Now we have 22 million acres of wonderful land there that are used for recreation and wildlife and hunting and fishing that have all come back. We can do the same thing here, and that's the opportunity. The problem is the opportunity won't be there very long. They're going to sell to some real estate developer or subdivider, and then we'll lose the chance forever.
There's also the argument these days that the government doesn't have the money to acquire any more public land.
Right, you always hear that, they don't have the money. Well, I'm a lobbyist, I work in Washington a lot. They have $1 billion to build a B-2 bomber, they have $500 million for fighter planes, they have $200 or $300 billion for savings and loan bailouts. The money is there, it all depends on where you want to spend the money. If enough people said, we have a chance to preserve the forest legacy forever and preserve the biodiversity and bring the wolf back and the caribou and keep this forever as a haven for millions of people and animals, we do it. The money's there. It's a matter of, that's why I said political will.
A viewer of this program just sitting there and wondering, well, what does it mean to me? What does it mean to she or to him that these northern forests are preserved?
Well, it means a number of things. For one thing, it means a part of what Wallace Stegner called your geography of hope. It's a knowing that there's a place near 70 million people that you can go and have a wilderness experience and experience all the values that are there. It's also a source of pure water for many of the northern cities' watersheds, and you've got to have the forest there to keep that pure. It's certainly a source of wildlife, but maybe most important, we're just finding out, it's a source of answers to questions we don't even yet know how to ask. For example, these forests contain medicines and they contain future foodstuffs like the ancient, we just found out the ancient forests of the Pacific Northwest have a little tree called the Pacific yew tree. The bark of this yew tree makes a chemical called Taxol, which melts ovarian and breast tumors. It's the best cancer cure for these tumors you found yet. And we didn't even know about it. We logged off 90% of it before we even knew about it right now. Well, these forests have treasures in them too. And that, to me, the biodiversity preservation argument is the strongest argument of all for people, especially when we have the opportunity to do something about it.
Are you making any headway in state capitals? Are you making any impact in the nation's capital in Washington on these issues?
We just started talking about this possibility about 3 or 4 years ago. We've made a lot of headway. At first, a lot of people were opposed to the idea of any kind of public acquisition in Maine. Now the public opinion has really changed around. The leadership hasn't changed very much. They still are opposed to it. But at the federal government level and across the country, people are becoming more and more aware of biodiversity and the need to save large ecosystems for these future questions that I've mentioned to you already. So I think in a few more years, if we keep getting the wherewithal to educate the public, we're going to find the money to do this. Already we found some appropriations to buy some key parcels, and we'll keep on doing that while we get ready for the big push.
And again, the target areas, Maine, upstate New York, where else?
Northern Vermont and northern New Hampshire. As I said, most of these lands are owned by large private timber companies, most of which would like to sell out. We only want to buy it from willing sellers, but there's plenty of willing sellers up there to really help us restore the North Woods to what it once was when Henry David Thoreau saw it in the 1850s.
In the West, you have much land in public ownership with national forests and
right.
Whatever, but of course, that's a whole other problem in terms of what the federal government is allowing occur in public lands.
We have to fight the federal government too, but at least we have some say over it, and we're on the verge of protecting the rest of our ancient forests out in the West because they were owned by the federal government, and we the people had, once we mobilized and organized, we were able to stop the cutting that was going on and start protecting it. We can do the same thing here.
We'll be back with Enviro Close-Up right after this.
The dump site we're proposing is perfectly safe, trust me.
The people who tell you that nuclear waste dumps are safe are stretching the truth. Trucks carrying radioactive waste will be traveling through our neighborhoods, so no area is safe.
As for our track record, accidents will happen. Clean it up.
Nuclear waste, the problem is bigger than you think.
Hope alone can't save our seas, save our soil, or save our skies. Act now. The world can't wait. You are the hope for the future.
Brock Evans is Vice President of National Issues for the National Audubon Society, and one of the key national issues in terms of the preservation of forest land has to do with the ancient forests of the Northwest. I mean, that's been a key problem in recent years.
That's right. For about the last 10 years, environmentalists all over the country have been really alarmed at the rate of logging and liquidation, really, of the ancient forests on federal lands, on public lands in Washington and Oregon and Northern California. Scientists have demonstrated that these forests are really rare ecosystems with a lot of biological treasures you can't find anywhere else on Earth, and yet the government, lobbied heavily by the timber industry, has just treated them as timber reserves. So we had to go to court to try to enforce the environmental laws. They were violating the laws too, and we've mounted a national campaign now, and we're on the verge, hopefully, of rescuing what's left of these forests now.
Brock, before Audubon, you were with Sierra. I mean, you've been doing this for a long time,
right,
kind of
right.
Going horn to horn, head to head with big government, mm-hmm. big business. Are we making any progress? I mean, are things getting better?
We really are, Carl. I've been doing this for about 25 years since I began in the Pacific Northwest, and to me, you measure progress in the environment, or maybe anything, not by what's going on right now and how tough it is now, because it's always tough. You measure it by looking back at where you started from and where you are. And if you look back 25 years ago, we didn't even have a National Environmental Policy Act. We didn't even have a whole lot of reserved areas and preserves that areas that we had right now, like the Alaska lands and others like that. All these things had to be fought for by citizens. But now we have a pretty strong network of laws, and we have a very strong network of reserved areas all fought for. So I'm optimistic. You know, we're getting there. If there ever was a hopeless lost cause, it was the idea of saving the ancient forest even 3 or 4 years ago. Now the President of the United States is involved enough to convene a summit to resolve it, and we're going to save a lot this time.
A lot's been happening, a lot's been gained, and it's an awful lot still to do.
Right.
This has been Enviro Close-Up. I'm Carl Grossman.